All right. As soon as I find where it is. One second. I know it's up here. Okay. Hold on. Here we go.
Florence. Shalom, Carmen.
Hey, Tamara. And hey, Suzanne.
Good to see you.
Good to see you guys too.
All right, now I'm going to share the sound. I think I'm finally getting it. Share the sound, share the screen. All right, here we go.
Forget
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Father, hallelujah. We just go to prayer. We do want to enter with thanksgiving and praise. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you. Thank you. Thank you that we have been granted another day to worship you, to praise you, to glorify you, to serve you. Father, we come before you. We come with hearts that are, oh, Father, you know what's inside of our hearts. We've struggled, some of us today, and others have had a beautiful day. Others have had days that have, well, days that have been better. But Father, we thank you that you have blessed us with breath in our lungs, that you have brought us together again. Father, that we can come to this platform and we can share with one another. We can be unified in prayer. And we come with humble hearts, Abba. We ask, Father, that you would just quiet us down, that you would help us to focus on what Sister Suzanne has to share with us this evening. Father, I thank you so much for my sisters. Father, I pray that all that are to be here tonight will be here. And Father, that this teaching would really speak to our hearts, Abba. Show us something of yourself. Show us something new, Abba. Teach us by your Ruach. May your Ruach HaKodesh unify us tonight. May we be of one mind, one spirit, one heart as we come together. Abba, we ask that you would protect this platform, that you would just protect the technology, and that there would be no interruptions from the atmosphere. In the atmosphere, there would be no disruptions, Abba. And may the words that we speak tonight, Father, may the words that come out of our mouths be glorifying to you. May they be words of kindness and truth and love. And help us, Father, to grow closer, not only to you, but to one another. We thank you and we praise you in the name of your son, Yahusha, our high king, higher king and high priest, Kohen HaGadol, our Messiah, our redeemer, our rewarder, our restorer. Hallelujah. Thank you, Abba. So be it.
Hallelujah. Woo! Oh, what a blessing it is to get together tonight, ladies. And I know Suzanne has a special presentation for us tonight. And just looking forward to just, gathering. I mean, I love Donna prayed for good days and bad days. Wasn't that it was a bad day. It just had many challenges today. But, Yahusha is our overcomer and he helps us get through them. And so I am so grateful and thankful for that. I had kind of a funny situation. I have a salon and guess what? The dryer broke. So I am at home doing towels and the guys will come and repair it in the morning, but yeah, can't go without towels. So I'm here doing towels tonight, but anyway, I'm blessed. I have a dryer myself to do it for him. So, but with all those things, Yas knows what we need when we need it. And I'm thankful for that and thankful for each one of you. It just warms my heart when I get to gather with you all. And so Suzanne, I'm just going to hand the mic over to you tonight.
Well, hallelujah. What a joyful praise of a song that was. And, here I am again, my excited me. So Sister Donna, when you opened up in prayer, I just calm down, Suzanne. Praise him. And it is such a delight to be at the table of our Abba's presence with each and every one of you sisters tonight. And I know I only see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at a time and here, but I, you know, I am excited that this is going to be a beautiful fellowship. I'm excited for how, you know, the Ruach is going to move in bringing understanding, increasing our awareness and so forth. So I'm just going to share my screen to keep me in the way and I don't go off here. And where's my little, okay, here we go. Where's my, is it this one? I guess it's that one. All right. Okay. So we have just celebrated the 50th day of the counting of the Omer, Shavuot. And what a blessing it was to have been at the service, you know, to have spent that time, to those who was able to join us. That was a wonderful time together. And you know, we're in this theme of counting. So in my mind, I'm still in this counting thing. And, you know, I think that for those who've really, you know, put their heart into, and I know that we increasingly do that each year, it seems that more and greater revelations are coming forth, but it's like, are we better counters? Are we better at counting, right? And so what do I mean by that? You know, you've heard me say Omer happened to share very similar Hebrew word to the word Amar. Okay, so I have some of the Strongs in front of you. And the Amar word stems from Genesis, you know, and let there be, and Yahuwah said, and Elohim said, let there be light. So the word said is Amar. Now, that Amar word means to say or to speak, right? So we're counting, you know, each day we were counting on the spoken word, you know, on what we say, right? And all of it is based off of the word of Yah. But I want to focus a little bit on counting just for a tad bit, because we were counting the Omer. And, you know, if you look at the Hebrew and the Greek definition of the word count, right, it basically means to, and so in Hebrew, it means to relate, to rehearse, to declare. And in Greek, in the Greek word, it's something to do with thinking, to think meet, to think fit, or to think right. And another translation in Greek is to consider, to take into account, to weigh, to meditate on. So what we're really doing when we're counting the Omer is that we're recounting the word of Yahuwah. We're declaring, we're rehearsing, we're thinking about it, how to make it fit. You know, we're considering, we're weighing it out. And so this is, you know, going to tie in a little bit to the Niddah. And you've probably heard, or you've probably seen the title of what we're going to talk about tonight. And I called it Practical Niddah. And the reason I say that is because what I'm hoping, I'm not going to have all the answers that you're probably looking for. Disclaimer. What I am going to share tonight is some of the connections I've made in the scripture based on where the Ruach has led me in my journey in studying the scripture. And so, and the focus really is the actual doing, or what is the use of this biblical truth? And it's more than, you know, more than just the concept itself. So that's kind of what I want to bring before your awareness, right? And then we're going to count on the Ruach, because the Ruach is going to lead us and guide us unto all truth, and how we're going to practically apply this in our everyday lives, right? So first things first, I think I just want to bring it, you know, Niddah. A lot of the times the focus really is on the woman. So, it's Niddah is not the woman. So if you look at the Hebrew definition, Niddah, it's impurity, filthiness, menstruous, set apart, you know, and you see the other layers of definition there, impure. So a lot of times we sort of see the woman as that, as fitting that description. But really, we have to see that the nidda is towards the blood flow. Okay, so now in the scripture, we need to also distinguish the blood flow. And how is that distinguished? And it has something to do with the counting, you know, because if you look at, for example, when it comes, when you think of blood flow, as far as we are, as women, right? As mothers, as you know, one who has just started their menstruating, you see that there's the menstruation aspect, childbirth, and irregular bleeding. So the distinguished part that we need to distinguish is in the counting, because the counting is a part of the process of the purification, right? And so when it comes to just regular menstrual period, you're looking at, we're counting 7 days from the first day of her period, right? Okay. And then they go mikvah, pure, to purify, right? And so that's for menstrual period. And then there's the aspect of irregular flow of blood. And all of this is found in Leviticus 15, by the way. So if it was an irregular flow of blood, we're looking at counting 7 days after her blood flow has ended, you see? So there's a little bit of a distinguished factor there. And then the third idea of childbirth is you count 7 days from the birth of a son or 14 days from the birth of a daughter. Okay, so point is, we just need to understand that there is an aspect of counting. So nidah, you know, it's also, what we're going to do now is we're going to read the passage in Leviticus 15 together. And I want to show you that the Hebrew word nidda is translated or transliterated in various English words. Okay, so let's read it together. Okay, so that's Leviticus 15, 19 to 24, just to show you. And if a woman have an issue, and this is in the King James Version, I believe, and her issue in her flesh be blood, she shall be put apart. So that word put apart is nida, right? I know it kind of sounds like put away, right? Kind of like, but it see, again, in the English, that's probably not the best translation. She shall be rejected in a way that I think that's more fitting. But anyway, so going back, she shall be put apart 7 days, and whosoever toucheth her shall be unclean until the even. Verse 20, and everything that she lieth upon in her separation. So now this word separation is again nida, shall be unclean. Everything also that she sitteth upon shall be unclean. And whosoever toucheth her bed shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the even. Okay. The next verse, let's just jump to the verse 23 here. And if it be on her bed, so the word it is referring to the nida, right? If it be on her bed or on anything whereon she sitteth, when she toucheth it, she shall be unclean until the evening. Okay. And then verse 24, and if any man lie with her at all, how interesting is this? And her flowers be upon him. You see the way flowers again is nida. He shall be unclean 7 days, and all the bed whereon he lieth shall be unclean. So I just wanted to show you that it does take one to study to really understand how we apply this in context, okay? And as you know me, I like to dig deeper in the word, in the Hebrew word. So if you were to go deeper in the word nida, you're going to see that it comes from a root word nadad. So this, I see this as speaking to the separation aspect a little bit, because what does nadad mean? It means to retreat, to flee, to depart, to move, to wander abroad. So a woman in her nida is going to go on a retreat. Interesting, right? So separation, when you think of separation, really it stems all the way back from creation, because we see that light divided from darkness, you know, water separated. When the waters were pulled into one, dry land appeared. You see, this idea of separation is from the very get-go. Shabbat was a set apart day from all the other days. Eve was separated from Adam's side, right? Man shall leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. So you see this idea of separation goes back to the creation story. And then you also see it's pretty significant because in Hebrews 4:12, even the word of Yahuwah pierces even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, joints and marrow and thoughts and intents of the heart, right? Interesting part, right? So we can be more in ekad with the Yahuwah spirit, right? So could the counting of our nidah while we're here on earth be like a retreat for us as a woman? Where are we going? To the fountain of the kingdom of Yahuwah. What? What do you mean fountain? Where are you going, Suzanne, right? So what does blood flow have to do with fountain or wellspring? So if you look at the word, the Hebrew word that translates into fountain or wellspring, makor, and I've pulled up a couple of verses here, Psalm 36:9, for with thee is the fountain of life, and in thy light we shall see light. Just let that, oh, isn't that a beautiful thing? And I'm sure you'll appreciate that more in a bit, but that word fountain there is makor. Proverbs 18:4, the words of a man's mouth are as deep waters and the wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook. That word wellspring is makor. So what's interesting, and how are you going to connect the blood flow with makor? So if you look at the Hebrew Strong's Hebrew word makor, look at what it means. Spring, fountain. One layer of definition is of the eye. The other definition is source of menstruous blood. The other definition is flow of blood after childbirth. Interesting stuff, right? So why do we see the I in that layer of definitions for makor? Well, did you know that the word eyes in Hebrew is ayin? So the first layer of definition of ayin is spring or fountain, right? You see how it's beautifully just flows like that. Okay, so what? Okay, so let's keep looking. So what's interesting about Yahusha when he rose again and he spent 40 days with the disciples and the apostles, in Acts 1, we see that he spoke only of the kingdom of Yahuwah. That's what he spoke about, right? And so I'm like, okay, interesting. And I've really been interested at looking at what is the kingdom of Yahuwah. Can you imagine just sitting next to our Yahusha, our Mashiach, those 40 days? He was just speaking about the things of the kingdom. Okay, so there are three things that I'm seeing so far about what it is to be a part of the kingdom. What does it mean to be citizens of the kingdom of Yahuwah? Okay, so three things. First one is that it has something to do with seeing. Okay, so if you look at John 3:3, it says, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of Yahuwah, right? But then it moves on a couple of verses later in John 3:5, it repeats the same thing. Yahusha repeats the same thing. And he says, except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of Yahuwah. You see how there's the seeing first and then the entrance, right? And then there's a third aspect to that that's about inheritance, inheriting about the kingdom of Yahuwah. And it's something about what are some of the elements that cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah? And I want to park that and we'll pick that up again in a bit. But I just want to focus on the first two points that I made, seeing and entering, right? So entering. If you look at John 3:5-6, most assuredly, Yahusha says, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of Yah. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. So I just want to quickly bring your attention to the word born. If you look at the Greek, if you study the word born, you know, I don't know if it's the first layer or you'd have to go further down, you're going to see the word ginomai, ginomai, okay? That is a Greek word for the definition or for the English word born. What does that mean? It means to become, to come into existence, to begin to be. So if you look at it, unless one is to become or to come into existence of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of Yahuwah, right? And then it makes a distinguish, it distinguishes between flesh and spirit. If you're born of flesh, you are, you know, that which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of spirit is spirit. So you see that the idea, the concept of birthing is linked here, both from the physical and the spiritual, right? So if you look at fleshly birth, you're looking at what's involved, just on a high level, water, right? There's the air, oxygen, or, you know, breath, right? And blood. But in the spirit birth, you know, the Yahusha teaches in science, if you may, you know, like he says, you know, in spirit, right? He only says one has to be born of water and spirit, or water and air, right? Breath, the Ruach. You notice how there's no mention of blood, right? That's what I'm trying to point out. So there's the flesh birth that has blood, spirit has no mention of blood. So that's the difference, the major difference. Okay, so I want to focus quickly on what water and air is, okay? If you take note in the Genesis account, in the creation account, you're going to find two elements that you don't see anywhere in the text that says, let there be. Like you're going to see, let there be light, let there be this, let there be right, right? But you're never going to see, let there be air, right? In other words, there's already the Ruach in existence. Let there be breath, like, you know. And then you're also never going to see, let there be water. You don't see that stuff, okay? So if you look at air, we know it's gas, right? It also is referred to as a water vapor. And I just want to, I'm trying to keep this very, something for us to understand and pick up. What's the difference between air and water? It has something to do with speed. What do I mean by that? If we were to add heat to water, so molecules speed up and it evaporates, it turns into air, right? Then what happens when it condenses, when the gas, the air cools down, molecules slow down, and it becomes water again, right? So you see how air and water is really one and the same. It's one and the same. What's the difference? Water is slowed down air, if you want to put it that way, right? So really, water is slowed down air. Okay. So I want to now connect the water and air with blood. I mean, actually, I'm not doing it. The scripture does. So if you look at Leviticus 20, verse 18, it's interesting where it says, and if a man shall lie with a woman having her sickness and shall uncover her nakedness, he hath discovered her fountain. Interesting. And then it says, and she hath uncovered the fountain of her blood. Right? So there's this idea of fountain and blood, okay? So, and we know that this is a, you know, it is an instruction as to what, you know, what not to do if you, you know, or what's going to happen when they are in this predicament, okay? And now I want to talk about the third aspect about the kingdom of Yahuwah, the inheriting aspect. Because earlier on, we looked at the seeing, the entering, and the inheriting part. In 1 Corinthians 15:50, this is very interesting. You know, Paul says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah. Have you, you know, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. So just in that verse alone, you can see that, okay, why blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah? Perhaps it has something to do with corruptibility, right? Okay, so if you look at, if we remember Adam, prior to the fall, I think you've heard, you know, just being mentioned, kind of thrown into conversation that Adam was a light being. I think, you know, even Matthew has referred to that. And what's interesting is that you know, if you study the account, you're not going to see flesh and blood in the Genesis 2 account. You're going to see him refer to himself as flesh and bone, right? Now, one of the definitions of the word Adam in the scripture is to become or to be red, right? Isn't that interesting? To cause to be red. Okay, so in other words, you know, it implies that he was not flesh and blood at one point. Okay, so that's just a part of the layer of the meaning of the name Adam. So at one point there was no blood involved. Okay, and the word Adam also means, if you break down the word in Hebrew, Aleph, Adam, Aleph, and Dam. Aleph means first, leader, right? First blood. Okay, so he's the first one that's been identified as with blood. Okay, so and you know what? Just by looking at practicality, we see that this idea of not having blood at one point, we can actually relate to it in our physical, in our lives, right? So for example, menstruation, right? A woman or a youth gets to, when we all get born as girls, we don't come menstruating right away, right? We reach that point where, you know, age 12 or whatever, that point where you are now going to menstruate. So really at one point you didn't have it, and then you're going to go through a menstruation cycle for how many years, and then you go through menopause, right? Now, so this idea of not having blood, did you know that, you know, even in embryo development, right, the first red blood cells appear on day 21, right? And around that time frame. And then if you look at upon one's death, you know, decomposition, you're going to see that the blood-stained fluid is going to get purged at about the third week. You see how, do you see the connections? Three, right? And then also, I don't know if you knew, but like, you know that our red blood cells, it's produced in the bone marrow, right? But the red blood cells it's not always red, in other words. So at one point, it was just a maturing cell that's produced in the bone marrow, right? And then there's this maturation period, right? There's this maturation period of about 7 days. And once the cell is matured and it reaches that the 7 day period, then it actually surrenders its nucleus. So did you know that out of every cells we have, the red blood cells is the only one that does not have nucleus? Because when they give up the nucleus, it allows them to have the ability to retain hemoglobin. So that's what gives the red color. And that's what transports the oxygen, right? Do you see what I'm saying? And how interesting is it that these red blood cells, they circulate the body for about 120 days before they get recycled again by the macrophages, right? So I just thought it was interesting too, that in Genesis 6:3, you know, there's a reference there that Yahuwah says, my spirit shall not strive with man forever. He's indeed flesh, and his days shall be 120 years. And, you know, anyway, that there's a whole study about that too. But I just wanted to point out that, you know, it's not always red blood is not all. There's a point in time where there's no blood. There's no red, in other words. Okay, so again, the name Adam, one of the definition means to be red. Okay, so if what seemed to have been a result of the fall, or as a covering because of the fall that ushered in corruption, perhaps that's the reason why there's this Adam, or to become red, right? So if water is slowed down air, if water is slowed down air, and you remember Adam was light, and then he became red. Could it be that blood is slowed down light? Okay, I'm just throwing that, you know, I'm throwing it out there, right? So if we understand Leviticus 17:11 says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. Okay, so what that's saying is our terrestrial body our flesh and blood is our earth suit, right? It is what we need to be here on the terrestrial realm, right? So again, you know, take notice that flesh and bone and flesh and blood, there's if you look at the creation story, at one point there was no flesh and blood. Okay. Now, if you look at after resurrection of our Mashiach, and he appears to doubting Thomas, right? What does Yahushua say to doubting Thomas? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have. You see that? So flesh and bones. So what does blood have to do with corruption? Okay. So, or I should say, does blood have anything to do as far as function is concerned from maintenance from corruption, right? So if you look at blood, you know, just the basic function of it is it removes waste, right? And it also, it takes the waste products and it brings it to the kidneys and liver, right? So, and then we see that at one point, Yahushua himself had to complete the process of the high priest, right? He had to go up to ascend to heaven, purify a part of heaven that seemed to have, that we know has been corrupted by the rebellion of Shaitan. We see that in John 20:17, when Yahushua tells Mary not to come, don't cling to me, for he has not yet ascended to the Father. You see? So there's this idea that there's this sanctification of the spirit that needs to be done. And it refers to that in 1 Peter 1:2. It says, in the sanctification of the spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Yahushua HaMashiach, our high priest, he must be kept undefiled to perform his priestly duty, as we understand as the Day of Atonement, right? So, okay. So life of the flesh is in the blood, okay? So if that's the case, if life of the flesh is in the blood, and we know that, you know, we can see that blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah, so we determine that this is a temporary terrestrial earthen vessel that we all have. So my question is, what is the life of the spirit? It's the air. It's the ruach, right? It's the breath, right? So, and then what's interesting is, okay, now, I've put down a summary there. So blood is slow down light, right? Because water is slow down air. So now, how do we reverse the process? So if we quicken blood, if we increase the speed of the blood, right? Could that be the light? Light is quickened blood. The same as if we were to increase the speed of the water molecules, it becomes air, right? So isn't it interesting that, you know, I think this is in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. So that word living there, right, means it's in Greek, zao in Greek, that means to breathe, breathing soul, to live, right? And so in other words, Adam was made, we, mankind is made to bear or carry the breath of the Most High, the image of the Most High, right? The last Adam, though, is pretty important, because the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. So the Greek word there, zupoe, whatever, means quickening, right? So what does that mean? The zupoe, or the quickening English word, means to cause to live, to make alive, to give life, to restore to life. That's what our Mashiach accomplished for us. He's the quickening spirit. So in other words, we are made as mankind, as living souls, we're made to carry his image, Yahuwah's image, the breath of the Most High. But Yahusha is going to cause us to quicken this flesh and blood. So he's going to help, he's going to cause to get our bright nature back. So Yahusha's resurrection has something to do with glorification of our bodies, right? And we see a little bit, a hint of this in John 1:4, right? in John 1:4, you're going to see in him, speaking of Yahusha, was life, right? And the life was the light of man. You see that? The word was there in Greek is meaning to happen or to exist. So in other words, the life of a Mashiach within his life is going to help us. He's going to exist. It's going to make exist the light of man and be like our resurrected Mashiach. Be like him. We will see him as he is, flesh and bone, bright nature. Okay. So I just wanted to point the flesh and blood aspect that is corruptibility of it, and it cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah. And based on the text, and we know this, we've heard this in many times before, that we are going to get our glorified bodies at one point, right? So I just want to quickly shift our attention in Eve's case, okay? And what was happening there with Eve? So I pulled up just here, just because it just beautifully describes it. In Jeremiah 17, 13, it says, O Yahuwah, the hope of Israel, all that forsake you shall be ashamed. Okay? And they that depart from Yahuwah shall be written in the earth. What did, you know, do you think that's what Eve did? And then the text goes, because they have forsaken Yahuwah, the fountain of living waters. So when Eve disobeyed, right? When in her disobedience, that was like an act of forsaking the fountain of living waters. Meaning she did not walk in the spirit, right? So remember, living waters, waters is the same as air, right? Water is just the reverse of air, right? So when Eve disobeyed, that equates to forsaking the fountain of living waters, just like what Jeremiah says in 17:13, likening it, or, you know, addressing it to Israel, right? Israel's rebellion, right? But what that means is she didn't walk in the spirit. Eve didn't walk in the spirit. So what happened? She fulfilled the lust of her flesh, right? So she forsook the fountain of the flow of the spirit, that quickened air, that breath. And basically, that's what caused her, the need for her and Adam to put on flesh and blood. So they were light beings. Now they've slowed down. They've got blood, right? And if you think about it, you know, that is also the departation, the departing from the Garden of Eden is distancing from the presence of Yahuwah. So it's the opposite of abiding, right? That's opposite of the abiding. So what happens is when we abide in Yahuwah, we will not be ashamed, right? When we draw near unto him, this is our how we are written in the book of life through our Yahusha, right? And abiding and drawing near Yahuwah is drinking from the fountain of living waters, okay? So now in the physical, again, right, this nidda, this blood flow, this being impure, or this carrying of filth, there is a need for us to be set apart. And you know what? Why? Because there's this aspect that blood flow is what's impure, right? So when we are set apart during our Niddah blood flow, right? Separation speaks to that, the things that pertain to worship, right? And that's how it's the example of that is in the scripture. Now we, you know, the text is very clear. Sexual intercourse is forbidden when you're in the blood flow, right? Because of the corruptibility that's involved in the blood flow. And sexual intercourse is really a picture of echadness, of being one, right? So you see how, you know, and then so when we obey the instructions of the Torah regarding Niddah, we are being a Hebrew, or we are crossing over from the physical to the spiritual, if you want to put it that way, right? Because we are going on a personal retreat with Yahuwah, right? Where we count our Niddah days, right? By recounting, relating, rehearsing, declaring the word of Yahuwah in our time set apart, because in our nidda separation days. And what that allows us to do is to think how to think meat. So now think how to be a helpmeet, right? To consider, to take into account, to weigh, to meditate on the living word of Yahuwah. So in our nidda days, we are also rehearsing. If you think about it, it's like a rehearsal. And remember, everything that I'm saying is found in the layers of definition of the word nidda, right? I just want to remind you of that. And I'm happy to share my notes. But when we're on our nidda days, we are rehearsing and made conscious or aware more and more that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahuwah, right? We cannot see the kingdom written, you know, in the, we are entering our Abba's presence through his Ruach HaKodesh, right? And so this is why Psalm 36:9, now do you see why it says, for with thee is the fountain of light. Sorry, fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light, right? So during our time of separation, we go on a retreat. We go abroad to be with our maker, our fountain of living waters, our fountain of life. And in his light, we see light. So these are the days, our nidda days, that we get to have our eyes wide open to see further revelations and insight from the word of Yah. Do you see how precious this time of nidda is? Okay. And then I love this, Proverbs 27:19. You know, a dear friend brought this to my awareness. I don't know if she's on the call, Anne Marie, you know, and as water reflects the face, so does the heart reflect the man. So think about the revelation and the insight, the revelation about who we are in Yahuwah. When we spend time, when we go on a retreat and sit at the fountain of life, fountain of living water, right? And then we get to reflect the face or true self, right? And so if we need to freshen up our eyes from afflictions and the burdens that we carry, the time of nidda can be the time to let our fountain of tears flow. Right? Because remember, the fountain, the wellspring, it also means the eyes, right? It also means the eyes. And then if you look at Jeremiah 9, verse 1, oh, that my head were a spring of water and my eyes a fountain of tears. I would weep day and night for the slain of my people. That we know that Jeremiah is the weeping prophet, right? So this is the time, really, when we have our abilities, when we can pour out from within us, right? And we position ourselves, really, the more we understand how to draw near to Yahuwah. This is just one of those process or one of those means that Yahuwah is revealing to us in how we can even be more drawn near to him. Because the closer we are to Yahuwah, we are positioning more ourselves into putting ourselves in a position of recipients, right? So we can be a recipients of the promises of Yahuwah. So we can continually realize what are the promises of Yahuwah that we are inheriting, right? Right now and what's to come. So, you know, really, I wanted to keep it short in the sense, because what I wanted was for us to really open up the conversation and be like, what does that mean to you? What does practical nidda look like to you based on the study of the definitions of the word? Like, how is that going to be applied to you now that you know what that's like, right? Now, and it's not me, I'm showing you from the scripture, right? So I wanna, this is, you know, I wanna open up the Sister Tamara, if you want to, go ahead and, you know, that was pretty much what I wanted to share.
All right. Thank you so much. I mean, that was wonderful, Suzanne, first off, wonderful. And I think just like I'm seeing some of the comments like, wow, if I would have known that, that would, when I was, you know, menstruating, then I would have had a whole different, maybe outlook on some things. But I did, you know, I jotted down a few things myself as you were sharing, because we want to remember that, being clean and unclean, that Yahweh always wanted to show a distinction between what's clean and what's unclean. And this is even one of those times that, you know, because what does it say? Our, you know, the heart is continually wicked. We need to keep track of ourselves. We need to watch out for ourselves. I feel like I'm going in and out. But anyway, so that was really one thing that really stopped, you know, this is an example of clean and unclean showing a distinction. And then thinking about Eve, okay? So here we are, Eve and Adam, they were in the image of Yahuwah. And I do believe that they were in the spirit in the garden, that when Eve did the sin, what did Yahuwah say? He said that, well, let me just read it, because it says in Genesis 3:16, to the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your pain in childbirth. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. So here he gave Eve a curse and a blessing. Okay, in some way, we can look at it like that. Like, you know, I mean, Yah gave us the responsibility to carry a baby in our womb. Okay, despite the sin that Eve committed. It was like a curse and a blessing, because it showed Yah's forgiveness, even in Eve at that point, because here she's blessed to bear this child. And I thought that when I think of the blood, even in that circumstances, you know, how when we have a menstrual period, we're flushed out of the bad stuff. We're flushed out. But then we're restored with the good blood. So here we are. It's like we have forgiveness. I mean, we get all the sin out and then we got forgiveness again. I mean, it's like a story on top of the story if you're really looking at that. And I was also thinking about Rachel, okay? So even in Genesis, if you remember Rachel, that she had the idols. Okay, she took the idols from her father's home, and it's in Genesis actually 31:35. I just want to read this one part to you. She said to her father, okay, so she took the idols, put them in a satchel, I guess, and then sat on them. Okay. And so you know, her father was angry, and she said to her father, let not my master be angry that I cannot rise before you, for the manner of woman is upon me. Her menstrual period was upon her. She knew that the distinction, that he would not look underneath her because of the menstrual period of her time. And so it just continually showed how there's even back then, a clean time and an unclean time. Men and women respected that time. And what you brought up, Suzanne, about how during that period of time, that is our time with Yahuwah. That isn't a time to look dirty or feel like we're dirty and, ooh, don't touch us. I shared a little bit last time, I think that this topic came up, was I was really blessed that my husband looked at it as a time of purity, okay? So what we did in my home is when I was on my menstrual, that I would put a towel on my part, on my side of the bed, and he would know that that was my time. And he and Joshua would not use the same bathroom that I used until that period of time was over. So out of respect, knowing that I was on that, it wasn't a it was more out of respect. And that was the time, if I would have heard your message, that would have been my total, Father, it's you and I. Because we have to understand that if you're married, it's very easy to, I know it was for me, like my husband was really the patriarch of the family. He knew scriptures. He knew all of that. I would go to him, hey, babe, how does this work? Because, I would get the answers from him, right? Or I just looked at him as someone, like I didn't maybe ask Yah as much. I asked him. But I share with you that now I realize that that period of time would be Yah and me. And because when we go before the Father, it's not going to be, well, he said this, and so I was just following him. It's not going to be like that. It's our own relationship with Yahweh. Even though we are one, but really it boils down to our salvation is between us and Yahweh. And so having that time to really, spend it with him in that way, I think is just a beautiful, I wish I was younger and that I could have that experience, if that makes sense.
And just a quick comment, Tamara, I really appreciate the connections you've made is absolutely wonderful. Even with Eve you said it was both a curse and a blessing. It's interesting because she partook of the tree that gave the curse and the blessing. And if you think about it, in amplified version, that's actually how it's translated. The tree of knowledge, good and evil. But anyway, the other thing too that I wanted to say is that, I know I've seen some comments in the chat. I wish, for those of us that have menopause, is that what you call it? Right. So we have to see it this way, that for us, the younger ones that are still menstruating, this is a rehearsal. It's also a rehearsal to how to be drawn near. So, at this point in time, I'm sure Yahuwah has matured. Sister Tamara, the growth that you're seeing Yahuwah is pouring out in your life, and you get to have that as well still. And so that was just what was interesting about it. Excellent. Thank you.
I mean, and even honestly, as for us, those of us that are in that menopause state, life doesn't slow down. We still experience some things. Maybe some of you experience hot flashes. Maybe some of you experience mood swings. Maybe a change in your appetite. There are a lot of different signs that Yah's trying to get our attention. Are we listening? Are we listening? Are we reaching for him even in those times when our bodies will speak to us? So I think it doesn't necessarily end yet with that moving into menopause. I think it is, we're mature. We're not on the milk anymore. Now it's up to us to be on our own, to recognize when we need Yah more, when we're reaching out, we're not feeling quite right. We're calling on Yah, not on pharmakia or even whatever we're doing. But I think that, whatever we try to solve, our eating habits or ice cream or whatever is trying to solve that need at that time. but, just to really reflect on, kind of what you're saying, that was just really good. And those were the things that popped out to me. Ellie, you have your hand raised.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you. I, over the years, I've looked at this And it appears, well, I put in the chat about the thing that was cursed was the ground. Yah did not curse either Adam or Eve. And tradition says that women are cursed and women get the monthlies and all that. And I don't see it as a curse. And I don't see having babies, and I don't see that time of the month as a curse. And I'm really thankful what Suzanne was sharing, because that's something that the father was showing me years ago, like in my spirit, you know. And I wanted to be that, that's time to be alone with him even more, right? And I remember telling my husband, my late husband, you know, I'd really like my own tent during this time. but he was, you know, Yah calls us special to him, especially during that time. Another thing is I trace back it, and I don't know how many of you have been under this kind of women are second class and all that sort of thing. And your desire will be to your husband and he'll rule over you kind of thing. And it's just really, really been difficult for me what I was exposed to with that. And I found that it was a different picture when I traced back words. And what in other manuscripts, the word is your turning will be to your husband and he will rule over you. And it was a warning. If you now turn from focus on me and you try to receive your acceptance, your whatever, from your husband, he's going to rule over you, because a carnal man must rule or be ruled or both. And when we're in our carnal, we lose our fellowship with our Father in heaven and know from him how to operate. And so we wind up in going into victim thinking. We wind up becoming not loving servants, but we wind up doing this subservient thing where we even submit our brains and our relationship to the Father, to the man, which Yah never intended. He intended us to put on the mind of Messiah. And it's not men put on the mind of Messiah and women put on the mind of your husband, unless your husband is Messiah. So these were things that have been very, very much of a encouragement, blessing, and challenge to me over decades.
Thank you, Ellie. And you know, I'm trying to address Shay's comment in the chat, but I do want to make it clear, it's not about sleeping next to your husband. Yes, you can sleep next to your husband. It's about intercourse during that period of time. Many men and women do not see a problem with that, but Yahweh does see a problem. Is it under the law? To me, it's just like a dietary law. I'm not going to eat pork. Okay, I could, but I'm not going to, because it's not beneficial to me. I've been saved by Yahusha. Okay, I would not have, you know, sexual intercourse with my husband, because it's not good for either of us during that period of time. Okay, and so that is what Yah is saying. He's saying that, you know, to keep yourself clean, focus on me, and during that time. But not, yeah, it's not about sleeping next to him. Not about sleeping next to him. Anybody else have any thoughts on that? On this? And thank you, Ellie.
Tamara, there's a comment too by Sarah Jean. I thought to highlight this. It's Sarah, I don't know if you want to share that yourself, or I don't know if you want me to just read it, or I'd love for you to be able to share your thoughts on that.
I'm not sure which comment, but you
can it was the one where you said at 9:02, you were tying Tamara's reflection back to the presentation. Also revealed. Oh, yeah.
Well, she was referring back to the pregnant, you know, woman is a curse and a blessing at the same time. You know, just, you know, tying it back to your teaching, when the woman is pregnant, we no longer menstruate for that period of time, right? So that means that blood is clean, is preserved for whatever blessing that's within us, right?
Yeah, that's really good. I like that, because, you know, at conception, have you seen those videos where they were able to take images of light sparking, you know, right at the moment of conception? So it makes sense that we're not menstruating during the time of life and light in our womb. That's awesome. Awesome stuff. Thank you. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
Sister Ellie, wonderful share as well. That was so heartfelt. I love that you share that. And the Ruach is leading and guiding you. Awesome stuff.
Yeah, and Josana, thank you, because Matthew does have a teaching from, I guess it's 7 years ago, and he was talking about that intercourse during menstrual. And it's, she says the teaching is called Generation Iniquity, DNA and the Book of Life. So that might be something to relook at.
And Stephanie,
what about people touching a person that is menstruating? Would that be like the law too?
Yeah, I don't think that is what he's saying there, Jana. I do know that there are some there are some Jewish sects that are very dogmatic about do not touch, you know, a person that is on their menstrual. Don't even be written, almost lock her up.
And even a lot of the messianics do that too.
Do they?
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's always things that take things extreme, just like, you know, the Jews. I mean, we could look at the, when they said, don't walk a Sabbath day journey, you know? I mean, that was something that the Jews put on the people, you know, to not walk very far on Sabbath. Anne, I got to get my plug. I'll be right back.
So just quick comment. Also to Sister Janet, we also have to keep in mind the difference in culture and the technology that we have today as far as how we maintain spillage. So we have like pads and stuff. So back then, I can't imagine they have that type of. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, it was funny that Josanna mentioned that generational iniquity video. I literally just watched it yesterday and I was going to bring it up. And then sure enough, she says it in the comments. Basically, he mentions quickly that your blood contains your soul. So if your blood contains your soul, and you have sex while you're menstruating, it's like you're sharing your soul with your husband. And it's just the way he worded it. And he said, you know, your husband's the one who's supposed to share his soul with you, like when you're having sexual intercourse, and not like the other way around, essentially. And that's why when husband and wife are having sexual intercourse, you notice that over time they kind of become one, because they start to behave like each other, right? And I don't know, he goes into detail about it anyways, but yeah, it's true. You guys really should watch that. It's pretty heavy video, but it was really, really interesting. And he did touch on exactly that. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, man.
Also, I wanted to mention, when I had my periods, we're more vulnerable. And we're open. I see my daughters now having their periods and being more vulnerable. And it's a time to just rest and receive the messages from God in our hearts too. I find, because we're all open, you know, it's a different state of mind that we're in. So it's time to retreat and receive.
So true. I mean, what about the emotions that go on during that time? The emotions that you feel during that time, we are a little more vulnerable. I totally agree with that.
I have my son's name, but my name is Marie.
Maddie? Oh, nice to meet you, Maddie.
My son's name that's there. Sorry about that.
It's okay. No worries. No worries. Oh, thanks for putting that link in the chat. So if anybody wants to snag that, you can. That was great. All right. Any other comments? I really appreciate it, Suzanne.
So someone in the comments, as someone said, to exercise if you're in menstrual pain. So good, that was Marlene. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it takes your mind away from the pain, doesn't it? When you move your muscles, you recharge your brain. That's kind of how it works, right? Because your battery packs, your muscle battery packs is attached to your brain. So when you're needing a recharge, go for a walk, run. Go on a bouncer, you know, right, Anne-Marie? is Joanne there too? Yeah, Joanne, that's right.
That's good. That's good. Trampoline. All right. Well, if there's no any other questions, then I will turn it back to Donna. Or run after your toddler. That's a good one. Yeah, right. Ira.
Yes. All right. Hallelujah. I don't know. I chose this song because, but as you listen to it, it's called Clean. You may have heard it before. We're talking about physical things, but we're also connecting it to spiritual, right? Mm-hmm. And so this is called Clean. And if you know it, I tried to get the lyrics to put it up and I just couldn't get it to fit on the screen tonight. So, but you may know it. And if you do, just sing along or just reflect on it, close your eyes and just realize that we are clean in Yahusha. I see shattered, you see whole. I see broken, but you see beautiful, and you're helping me to believe. You're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing to take. You can make relief. You wash me in mercy, and I am clean. What was dead now lives again. My heart's beating inside my chest. Oh, I'm coming alive with joy and destiny. Oh, because you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing to tell. clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can make worthy. You wash me in mercy, O Lord, and I am clean. Sacrifice your blood, the red and baby white. My dirty rags are purified, and I'm clean. Oh, washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood, the red and baby white. My dirty rags are purified, and I'm clean, I'm clean, I'm clean. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood for red and baby white. My dirty rags are purified. There's nothing to tell me that you can make worthy. You wash me in mercy, and I am clean. There's nothing to tell that you can make worthy, oh yeah. You wash me in mercy, and I am clean. We thank you for what you have done for us. Your blood flowed red, but you made us white, white as snow. Oh, Yahuwah, I ask if at this time, if there there are any of us, yeah, who have not forgiven ourselves, who have not been washed in your blood, who have not realized that because of your sacrifice, because of the blood, your blood that washed over us, that we no longer have to carry guilt and shame, unforgiveness, bitterness. Father, that you would speak to our hearts. Father, that you would allow your love to flow over us right now and bring us to the truth and the realization that we are clean in you. And Abba, if our garments have become spotted or dirty in any way, that you would show us, that you would bring to our awareness, Father, that you are waiting with open arms to cleanse our garments, that we would ask for forgiveness, that we would lay down those dirty garments in front of you and ask you to clean them. We thank you, Abba, that in you there is no guilt or shame. And we can walk in purity. We want to be your pure, spotless bride. And I thank you, Abba, tonight for this wonderful teaching from Suzanne and for the great insight and comments by my sisters. Thank you, Father, for how you continue to lead us in your truth. Hallelujah. Pour out your joy in us tonight as we leave, as we go about our business, as we go about your business, as we go to lay down our heads tonight on our pillows, Father, as we go back to our families, Abba, that we would walk away in your truth, in your love, in your joy, in your peace, in total shalom. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. And Father, as you give us breath according to your will tomorrow, may we walk with kingdom purpose. May we have divine appointments even now, Father, to share your good news and to increase the kingdom, Father, for you. We give you all glory and honor tonight for anything that we have learned, for anything that we have shared, Father, that was of you, for anything you have taught us, and for how you've touched us this evening. We thank you. And Father, I ask that you would just bless each and every sister here tonight and the households that they represent, Father, that you would continue, Father, to show them your goodness, your kindness, and your love for them. And may we continue, Father, to walk together as one in you under the headship of your Son, Yahusha, our King and High Priest.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So be it.
Hallelujah. And I would just like to add to that. I just really feel moved right now. Oh, dear Yahuwah. We renounce any negativity that has been spoken over us in regards to our menstrual periods. Mm-hmm. Anybody that has said that we are unclean, that we are dirty, that we are, you know, you orchestrated this plan, Father. And yes, you have done it in a distinction, but not in a perverse way, Father. And we just renounce anything that has been spoken ill over anybody. From a young child, from a young girl's point, Father, we renounce those words. And Yahuwah, we want to lay down some things before you on this altar, Father, for we petition. If there is anybody in this room right now who has any menstrual troubles, and I'm speaking about cysts on your ovaries, I'm speaking of be gone in the name of Yahusha. that the womb may be flowing with the blood as it should. I pray, Yah, that you would cleanse it, cleanse the womb that is being attacked by these cysts, Father. And in fact, pop them, Yahuwah, and may the blood just circulate as you have designed it to do, Father. We pray for anyone who is pregnant right now in the mighty name of Yahusha, that that pregnancy would be beautiful and go forth as you had created, Father, that there would be no problems or issues, that that womb and that body would be made whole in the mighty name of Yahusha, that it would, that her breast will produce the milk that needs to feed that baby in the right way, Father, in the mighty name of Yahusha. We pray against any preeclampsia, that it was not allowed in this body of this, of those that are pregnant, Father, that it would be gone. We pray against any hot flashes that are not of you, Father, anything that has been hormonally instituted, Father, that they be gone, that if they are hot flashes that are from a true menopause, then let it be so, and let it get our attention to focus on you, Father. We denounce any hormonal issues that anybody has spoken over us, Father, for we know, Yahuwah, that you have the right frequency in our bodies. You have the right hormones in our bodies and just what we need, Father. We plead the blood of Yahusha, and we pray, we thank you that we are washed by the blood. We pray against any urinary tract infection that has caused a sister to slow down or not urinate as they should. We ask you, Yahuwah, to completely heal that, that it doesn't need antibiotics, but it only needs you, Father, that can heal that urinary tract infection. And Father, we speak against any weight gain that has been caused because of some hormonal issues or maybe some habits that we need to correct, or maybe just whatever that weight gain issue, Father, I just pray against that. I ask you, Yahuwah, to help us, Father, to have better habits, better choices, Father, to eat your food, your living food, and not those of the fast food, Father. We thank you, Father, that you have given us the true diet. We renounce anything that has been put in our bodies that are not healthy, Father. We just ask you, Yahuwah, to reverse the effects, Father. Yes. We speak against any lymphoma, any blood issue that is attacking those lymph nodes, Father. I just ask you to heal it from the top of the head to the bottom of the feet, that the flow of blood will be gone, that will be right, that those lymph nodes would shrink, Yahuwah, that you, Father, would just put your hand upon those and would heal them completely, Father. And we pray against anybody who is having trouble getting pregnant, Father. We ask you to open her womb, open the eggs, or to allow the sperm to connect with the eggs so that it would be made so, Father. You know what these people need. You know what these sisters need. And I just know, Father, that you are our healer. You are the one we turn to when we are experiencing these things. And we thank you, for we will give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory for the healing that is going to be manifested in these sisters. We thank you for marriages, Father. I thank you, Yahuwah, that you are bringing breakthroughs in regards to marriages, that the chains have been broken, that what they thought was a good marriage, what their parents had, that that was the type of marriage, that you are breaking the generational curses, and you are giving them the type of marriage that you would want, an echodness, a oneness, a completeness, no secrets, no secrets, no yelling, no, when there's conflict, that they come together as one in meekness, Father, in meekness, that would be resolved, Father. We thank you, Yahuwah, for courtships that are happening, Yahuwah. And you know, Father, what needs to be handled and how it should be handled. I pray that you would give them guidance and direction in those ways. For, you know, we don't look at dating dating is just a way to break up. We look at courtships and we move forward in the friendships that are coming forth, that we would be virgins,
yes,
that we would accept our husbands as you have designed it. And if there hasn't, we aren't, then I pray, Yahuwah, that you would break any soul ties from any person that has been in contact with us, Father, that is not made in a holy union. Break those off. Yes. And Yahuwah, I pray for the single ladies right now. Yahuwah, you are our husband. You are the one who fills the need. And we're thankful for this period of time in our lives, Father, where we can wake up and it's you we turn over to in our beds. It's you we get up for. It's you that walks us through the day. It's you that provides for us. And we feel that security in you, Father. We're just so thankful for that. And I pray for the widows, Father, for the longing for their husbands, the yes, missing them in the physical, but yet you provide in the spiritual, Father. Continue to provide for them financially, emotionally, in every way, Father. I pray for them. And I pray, Yahuwah, for the caregivers. Yes. Those that are caring for their mothers, their fathers, their daughters, their grandparents, or even a friend. Give them strength to do what they need to do, Father. Because it's times like that, that the weakness and the physical can be a lot and draining, but you may you lift them up, Father, on eagle's wings.
Yes.
I pray, Yahuwah, for those that are transitioning from their moving or a job, yes, or a new status in their lives, Father, that you would continue to transform them in the name of Yahushua HaMashiach. Yahuwah, you are the most loving, kindest,
yes,
Father, that we could ever ask for.
Yes.
We thank you, Yahuwah, that you've chosen us, that you have given us your grace, your love, and your mercy every day. Even when we mess up, Yahuwah, and others won't forgive us, when we come to you in complete repentance, you do. We're so thankful.
Thank you.
We love you, Yahuwah.
And we, yes,
without a shadow of a doubt, that you are our true Elohim. We love you and serve you, give you all the honor and the glory, for all good things come from you. And we thank you in the mighty name of our High Priest and King, Yahushua HaMashiach.
Hallelujah.
So be it.
Hallelujah. So be it. Hallelujah.
Yeah, blow the shofar. Woo!
Hallelujah.
Be it. Wow.
Hallelujah.
Oh, blessing.
Hallelujah.
All right. Well, thank you for spending your evening with us, ladies. It's been a joy. Thank you again, Suzanne and Don.